Your grace and your to his house in Gibeah of Saul. Samuel did not see Saul again until the day of his death, but Samuel grieved over Saul. And the Lord was sorry that he had made Saul king over Israel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him, for the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shema pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He was sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thank you. died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view, even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view. We know him no longer than that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Christ.
Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground, and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow, he does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
With many such parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them, except in parables. Amen. As we look at the gospel reading today, we need to remember that Jesus was speaking in a word who would have understood and would have been deeply connected to his use of seeds, plants, and parables he uses to explain nature. God and how the reign of God take root. After all, their lives and livelihoods were tied to the land, and the success or failure of the crops they sowed. They would have recognized the promise of new life inherent in Christ's parable, and the life-giving nature, and the hope of that promise. These days, except for maybe the gardeners of us, and I'm thinking those like Deacon Steve and his garden crew, nurturing corn babies and other plants in the safely observing garden, we have lost that connection. We simply go to the supermarket, the fruits, the vegetables, the miracle of the seed are just there to be purchased. We have not witnessed the miracle. We have forgotten the mystery of the seed, the power of the soil, how something so seemingly dead and lifeless creates new life, new sustenance, how the inevitable outcome of the sowing over time, of course, sprouts and produces a plant, and the plant grows and produces the fruit or grain that provides our sustenance. As I reflected on the parables, attempting to hear them with the perspective of those original listeners, it was helpful for me to remember a pastime of childlike wonder when I seemed to fully grasp the mystery and hope contained in the seed. Hope and mystery and faith in the process of the seed inevitably becoming new and abundant life. I was reminded of that time recently and while walking into the school where I work, I noticed a bunch of dirt-filled styrofoam cups lined up outside of my elementary classrooms. Seeing those cups, I was immediately transported back to a time in my days in elementary school when I was provided with those white styrofoam cups. My teacher or class potting soil, or pumpkin, or tomato seeds and plant them. The lesson we had to learn from the science project did not seem to matter, only the unbridled amazement that somehow the seemingly lifeless seeds I had placed in the dirt in my cup were miraculously transformed into a sprout with green leaves poking at the top of the soil. As a child, I had no idea how this would happen. But I was filled with hope and complete faith that it would. I can still remember holding that cup in my hand when the seed eventually germinated, broke the surface, looking at that green sprout and feeling like I was witnessing a miracle. great mystery all at once. Just how this occurred. And was that answer really important or needed? Because the joy, mystery, and inevitability and sprout is all that we have. New life for the seemingly lifeless seed and dirt. Now with that childlike faith and wonder and acceptance of the mystery, remembering that we are all children of God, let's hear Jesus' parable again. The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground, and the seed would sprout, grow, and he does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, and then the full grain of the head. Grain is ripe, at once he goes in with the sickle, because the harvest has come. We do not know how. It is a mystery, but we have faith that the kingdom will and is emerging, that the earth will produce of itself, and the reign of God will and is being realized within all the quiet and chaos of our world, within all the struggle, the love, and suffering, the moments of relief, of pain. The kingdom will be and is emergent. The Holy Spirit is with us, advocating to us to help and flourish in the kingdom. But no matter, it will continue to push the stalk up and grow into abundant life. It is a mystery, and we might not be able to fully understand and grasp it, but that does not mean that it is surely not occurring. We can live into this mystery. We can tap into the faith and hope that it provides for us to step courageously out and confront the struggles in our own lives, within our community and world. This mystery reminds me of the famous quote from Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. Yes, change, justice, and the triumph of love can take a long time, but it does happen, and it is happening. As we confront the outcomes of the devastating pandemic, community, nation, in the midst of confronting its racist past and present, the economic suffering, homelessness, many of our siblings, the destructive impact of climate change, to name but a few of the needs of the world currently face, we can rest assured the work we are doing to build a loving community is not wasted, that it deeply matters, and that the kingdom and reign of God is behind us, amongst us, and in front of us, that the hope and faith that Christ points to and provides us in the parable can be used to carry us through tough times and inspire us to take on the work we need to do, secure the knowledge and mystery wonder of the kingdom, the mystery of the sown seed. There is much power in the deeply faithful people trusting the Spirit. In the second parable of today's gospel reading, we can find additional hope, faith, knowledge, and inspiration of what kingdom life, beloved community, is all about, and how we might respond to it. For as Jesus explains, the kingdom is like a mustard seed, the smallest seed on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up, it becomes the greatest of all shrubs, putting forth large branches that the birds can take sanctuary. The first time I heard this parable, I always wondered why Jesus did not use the mighty cedar tree, or perhaps a plant that would have been seen as a bit more economically viable than a mustard plant, to explain the kingdom. Why a mustard seed? But then I came to realize that the kingdom that Jesus speaks of is not the kingdom of empire that the cedar tree would have represented, or the kingdom of commerce that a cash crop, corn, or wheat would have represented. No, it is a shrub, a strong and mighty shrub, whose seemingly sole purpose is to produce branches that can provide sanctuary to the creatures of the earth. This would not be a kingdom whose purpose and strength is going to be one of political, military, or economic power. For those goals and outcomes are transitory, security, and love for all. The kingdom of new and resurrected life, where, from now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. As Paul reminds us of the second letter to the Corinthians, we view all now through the lens of the resurrected Christ. However, as we absorb the childlike wonder and mystery of this odyssey, and respond to the reassuring knowledge of this inevitable kingdom and the hope and faith it inspires, we must still deal with the undeniable suffering of our current world and how we reconcile this. As a community, as a church, do we sit reassured in our pews that the kingdom is inevitable and that we just need to patiently wait? Should we not lean on the arc of the moral universe that Dr. King speaks of? Bending towards justice just a bit quicker? Is not some action required on our part as followers of Christ? I feel that the answer to this question is a resounding yes. Jesus has provided us with two parables that contain much mystery, power, hope, and faith in the certainty of the kingdom in order to empower and encourage us to take on the action that occurs in both. The sowing of seeds. And although the world will always need the big, bold individuals to create the space and opportunity for change and justice, as Jesus reminds us, the kingdom emerges from the smallest of seeds. Small acts that we may never know the outcome of, but can create a new shrub, new branches, providing sanctuary and greater kingdom space. For this, the mystery of the sowing seed. Right now, as we emerge from the pandemic, we must not forget those who still do not feel safe around others, who are still at home, maybe joining us through our Facebook community, and not visibly here with us today. Do not let them be forgotten. Reach out and let them know they are in your heart, and you feel their presence in your lives. Sow small seeds. As we celebrate Pride Month, let us not forget that there are still many of our LGBTQ siblings, especially youth, that are not yet experiencing the joy of Pride, secure in the knowledge that they are beloved, rejected by their families and communities, struggling to be accepted. We are called to reach out, to be a shrub of sanctuary and love for them. If you know of someone dealing with this struggle, perhaps you can just let them know that you care and accept them. Sow small seeds. Confronting our peoples of systemic racism that is literally killing our brothers and sisters of color, we can take the time to become more educated, have difficult conversations, and face hard truths about our communities, to demand change, speak truth to power, to love just a little more deeply, to become anti-racist. So, small seeds. As we walk past our in-house sibling, just outside the doors of our church, who may be suffering from darkness, mental illness, or just victims and survivors of unfortunate circumstances, maybe just offer a kind word, or a smile instead of looking away, or worse, withdrawing back from your presence. I know that this will not even put a dent in the illness and crisis we face in our community, but it might just let them know they are seen, providing a moment of grace for them, and it might just plant a seed in your heart to volunteer for the shelter ministry, or for advocating for affordable housing at the city council meeting. So, small seeds. Maybe we can step away from our phones and read a book or watch a documentary that addresses and provides suggested solutions to one of the many issues we are confronted with. And we can meet with others to discuss it. This might just spur us on to further action. So, small seeds. These are but just a few examples of small seeds that as a community we can sow, and I'm sure there are many, many more places that need a small seed sowing that deserve the mystery, and the hope of the mustard shrub, and the sanctuary it provides. And we also need to challenge and ensure that the church realize that purpose. To strive boldly through profound labors of readjustment and construction, to establish the kingdom of God, the kingdom of love on earth. Now is the time, so, to do the work that needs to be done for the love community, to build the love community. So, small seeds. As we do the work of sowing small seeds, let's not forget to look behind us and around us in hope and faith to see all the seeds that have been sown by this community. I think of the showers, manaments, deconstructing racism, sacred ground, the continued live streaming of our English and Spanish services on Facebook, the Bible studies, the movie and book clubs, the Zay and conference services, music industry, the Zoom coffee hour discussions, the amazing online English and Spanish services throughout the pandemic, and so many other CSO and numerous mention. Look back and around you, a hillside full of mustard plants. As this is my last Saturday, this is an accepting, active, prophetic, and loving community, know that my departure is still very next week. But I leave this community with the small seed you have planted in me. You can be sure wherever my future ministry journey takes me, what I have witnessed, felt, and learned in these years, the small seed you have sown will be with me, and it will continue to grow. And I will be a far better and effective sower of seeds. Thanks. And thus, with my departure in mind, I would like to offer you a prayer that will instill in those who are working the church back up and win. May the Spirit of God draw you out into the wilderness road. May she send you chasing chariots and smashing the alabaster beyond all propriety. May she bring you to dark-skinned eunuchs, Samaritan women, and young ones. Dream wild dreams, and rich rulers who long to fit through the eye of me. And may they receive you into their homes and worlds, so you might teach and convert one another, and may you enter the waters of baptism together, and guide and rise in Christ together. In the name of the Creator, and the Son,
gather as people created and renewed by the life-giving breath of the Holy Spirit. Let us open our hearts to her compassionate touch as we pray. For your creation and all its creatures, for our sense of stewardship for all you have created, let us pray.
Lord,
we pray.
should have known you
with me. Peace be with you, my love, too.
Thank you.
that all kinds of prayers, we're going to do YouTube lives. Because it's pretty interesting. So we're going to start with our prayers on Thanksgiving, then do our birthdays, and then we'll do our
communion. Ezekiel Alamanza is graduating from elementary school.
What?
Ezekiel
Alamanza. Ezekiel? Okay.
And Lord, you have called your
be the person and the fruits we may create in you. Amen. And Lord, we give thanks for John, as he has served among us this year, as he has served on Zoom, and now these last few weeks in person, getting to know our community under the strangest of times. So Lord, as he returns to his home parish of St. John's, may the seeds we have planted in him continue to grow. May he, in the ministry in which you are calling him, may he find you as the one who guides him, who gives him clear direction, who brings out in him all the blessings and richness of his life. And Lord, as Kelly celebrates her birthday this week, and as they move forward together in life and in this journey towards serving you, Lord, bless them, watch over them, and help them continue to strengthen, support, and love one another in this journey. And so, John, as you go forth from this place, know our gratitude for your time here. Know God's gratitude for your willingness to offer yourself. And know that you cannot leave us behind. Amen. Amen. How many years? To care for her on good days and hard days, in sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer, for better, for worse, for all that life might bring, until you are parted by death.
I do.
And so, God, we just ask that for more years, more decades if we can have, may they be in our midst and stand before you as signs and symbols of your love for our broken world. Because, Lord, we need to know that love is true, love is real, and love is real. So we may rejoice and Glenn be for us embodiments of your love. Amen. Amen. Woo! Good. And Cecilia is just back from being the accompanying sister with her sister Joan, who is undergoing treatment for cancer. And so we're going to bless this prayer shawl, and we're going to send it on to Joan with all the love and healing presence and power of this congregation. So if you want to raise up hands, whatever you want to do, if you just think good thoughts of healing for Joan, all of them. Holy God, this prayer shawl was knit not with a specific person in mind, but in each stitch, a prayer for healing, an offering of love. And so, as this prayer shawl makes its way to Joan, as her sisters and her family and her friends circle around her in love and prayer, may this prayer shawl, as it wraps around her, let her always remember that she is held in love, that there are communities whom she might never know praying for her healing, for her life, for her victory in this battle of cancer. So Lord, we ask that you might bless this shawl. This shawl that it is an embodiment of our love and praise. And that you might touch Joan through the power and make her well. Amen.
Thank you. send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that he may be acceptable for him being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your cross, and bring us to that heavenly country where with the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Luke, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Spirit.
Amen.